came here because they thought this was a voice acting panel for an anime and raise your hand. Okay? How many of you thought this was a voice directing panel for anime and video games? Alright, well, truth be told, there was a bit of a sort of a communications error when I proposed this panel. They had, I told them I wanted to do a voice directing for anime and video games panel. And somebody, one of my kids said, oh, voice acting for anime and video games panel. They put it on the schedule as such. So, honestly, I can tell you, you know, I am a voice director. I have worked as a voice actor as well, not as much as a lot of the other people here, but I can give you a perspective of what it is to be a voice actor in anime and video games, but I wanted to talk a bit about what my job is to be a voice director, and what I would have to do is sort of give you both sides of the coin. So, but if you feel free, like there's been a little bait and switch in here, I won't hold it against you if you have one to walk out on me at this point.
No, we're actually excited. This is going to be awesome. Yeah.
But let me start by introducing myself. My name is Jonathan Klein. I am an alcoholic. I am a voice director. I've been working as a producer and a voice director for both anime and video games since about 1999 or so. I've been working mostly as a voice director since about 2001, so I guess it's about 15 years for me from now doing stuff. I started off in anime. Well, actually, technically, I started off in, before that, I started off in live action directing voiceovers for commercials and industrial videos, because that was what my company did. My company's called New Generation Pictures. And we would do, before we got into anime and video games, we would produce commercials and industrial videos for Japanese and American clients who wanted to go into Japan, or Japanese clients who were trying to go into America. And they would ask us to localize their videos that we produced for them into English or Japanese. So I would direct voiceovers for people with usually just more announcer type of voice stuff into one language or the other. And so that's how I sort of got into this, but there was a point in that industry where the economy in Japan was just kind of going to pot. And as a result, basically, I lost a lot of these clients that were hiring us to make these industrials and commercials. And we were like, hey, well, what do we do that we've developed this interesting skill set of localizing between Japanese and English. What can we apply it to? And then I saw a site for Anime Expo in California. I'm sure, Kevin, you know Anime Expo.
Yeah.
I thought it was nice as Sakura-con, of course, but back then. But back then, what happened was we said, hey, you know, maybe there's a demand for anime and demand for our work in anime. So we started going around making the rounds to the different companies and approached them about doing that. And as a result, we got hired. First, we got hired to do like translations, like to do for the subtitles. I remember our first project was Golgo 13, Queen Bee. And the only way I can describe it is he shoots and he scores. That's about it. That's basically mostly that. That's what that movie's about. And I'll keep it at that. I'll keep it clean like that.
We all start somewhere.
Yes. But the point was, I didn't direct that. And basically, when I started off as a producer, when we produced our first dub, I was a little nervous to start actually doing the voiceover direction. So I hired a guy, rainbow-haired kid, who I met at a toy store down the street from our office, Japanese anime toy store called the Joy Store. Had rainbow hair, his name was Taliesin Jaffe. And Taliesin said to me, because I was old school anime, he was like new school anime, basically. And he was like, oh yeah, you should take a look, I made this band up of Evangelion. And I was like, oh yeah, sure, I'll take a look at it. Yeah, I'm thinking it was gonna be like, awful things that, you know, a bunch except I didn't know that he actually had an entire family that worked in Hollywood, in the film industry. And he had Roddy McDowell, the late great Roddy McDowell, do the voice of Fugitsky in his family. And I was like, oh, we should hire this person to direct our first dub. And so, basically, I kind of sat in and watched him as a producer direct the first shows, which was at first was a show you probably have never heard of and hopefully you'll never see called Nazca. Although if you ever watch Malcolm in the Middle, you'll see some clips of the opening segment.
Oh, yeah.
We actually got that on there, but it was like that was something we one of the actors who worked for us was actually like the assistant to the producer Malcolm in the Middle, and he said, oh, we need to put some anime in the show. And I said, why would we put this show in the show? And then we worked together on a show called Neon 7, and then we worked together on a show called Hellsing, which some of you might have heard of.
Yeah.
And, so watching and working with Taliesin, I got to pick up a lot of the way he worked with actors, and it's an interesting technique. Now, my background is also in film production. I went to film school out in California, and so I learned to be a director, but behind the camera. And directing for voice acting was a completely different experience because there is no camera. You're basically, voice acting is about acting with your voice. But the best way to describe it is really, to be a voice actor, it's not like, well, you can be an actor or a voice actor. It's not one or the other. The best way to describe it is like an actor, because there are a lot of great actors, but a lot of great actors can be great voice actors. An actor is like studying to become a doctor. You go and you take 6 years of medical school, and then you intern, and you can then, when you graduate and you got your degree, you can go and be a general practitioner or a pediatrician or something like that. But let's say you want to be a heart surgeon. That means you've got to study a bit more and learn a specialty on top of the skills of becoming an actor. And that's what all about being a voice actor is. It's not just something you can sort of like, I don't have a face for film, so I'll be a voice actor instead. It's really an interesting thing because you're turning your craft that you learn as an actor into something that is, really in some ways you're just using one element of your body. When you learn to be an actor, you learn to use everything from your face, your body expression, all the movements, the set, your costumes, everything goes to creating your character. You don't have that luxury. And it's even doubly hard when you're doing dubbing for Japanese animation because you're basically trying to fit your lips into somebody else's performance and yet at the same time trying to make it your own performance.
Yeah.
It's not something that, because we don't want them to just parrot the Japanese. It's the, it's not voice parroting, it's voice acting. You have to take a performance and make it work in English. And if you were to literally copy the Japanese word for word or sound for sound, it would be pretty annoying. As much as a lot of you might listen to the Japanese dub, part of the problem, one of the things that makes it a little easier to listen to sometimes to some of those voices is that you don't understand the language per se of what they're saying. So you're taking it in and sort of transposing the ideal performance, reading the subtitles underneath it, so it helps to take down like some of the things about the way the voice sounds. That's why when you hear a bad dub and you hear somebody literally trying to parrot the Japanese, you say, "Oh God, what? That sounds awful!" But they're sounding just like the Japanese, but you understand them. That's why it's to you, it's in your own language. You understand it, so therefore you understand what's going on. And now you can realize what's good and what's bad. There are people who I know in this business from the U.S. side, and believe me, everybody. There are how many of you don't listen to dubs? Question: raise your hand. A few of you. Okay. Well, is it because the question is? Somebody will say, "Well, dubs suck." I used to get that a lot when we started off in the early, you know, early 2000 through 2005. I would get a lot of the dubstep criticism. And there was a fair share of bad dubbing in the 90s, because there was a time, there was a Japanese anime was sort of coming to a second phase, basically, as a result of, like, you know, Robotech coming over and things like that.
It was sort of like the awkward teen phase.
Exactly. It was more like, we just don't know what to do, kind of thing. Let's go, we got a script, we got some actors, you know, maybe we try sometimes hiring, like, cartoon, you know, actors who work on Saturday morning cartoons or tell strip syndication cartoons. And they just didn't understand how, you know, the performance was supposed to be, like, trying to do it awful, like a Saturday morning cartoon, when they didn't understand that the audience for the Japanese anime was much higher in terms of, like, you know, in terms of the age level, that if you kind of dumbed it down, it just didn't work. But I think starting in the early 2000s, there were a lot more people. What we did is when we were producing our first dubs, we listened to some of the dubs, and we saw what worked and what didn't work. And we tried to pick out those elements that worked and try to avoid those traps that people would fall into that didn't work. And that was one of the things Taliesin, why it really was impressed with Taliesin, because he sort of understood how to pull out performances from actors. A lot of them had never worked in, never worked in Japanese animation before. I mean, I know Ryan McDowell has done voiceover for tons of things, you know, throughout his lifetime. But the point is, there is sort of a unique skill that what a director is all about, to say, is my job is to pull out the best performances I can from actors. If I'm just telling them to read the line that's on the page, and just say, just read the line that's on the page, do it this way, that's not being a director. That's just somebody telling somebody, do this, copy me, and that's not the way a director works. A good director knows how to talk to an actor and explain to them what it is they want in their performance without actually having to sort of say, okay, repeat after me, do it this way. Hi, my name is this, blah, 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 blah. You know, if you do it that way, that's not really directing. It's almost condescending in the way you're saying, we don't trust your skills as an actor to create a performance. I'm gonna tell you how to do it. And that's usually like a bad way to start a relationship with a voice actor.
Now, there are, you playing God. Yeah.
Well, it's even worse than that. It's like you're saying, I don't think you have the ability to do it right. And I'm better than you. And I can't make that claim because I didn't have the same. I had some actor training. That was one of the greatest things I learned, was when I was studying to be a director in film school. They said the first thing you're gonna have to learn is what it feels like to be behind the camera. So you're gonna take some acting classes, because you need to learn how to communicate. Communication is the key to a director. If you cannot express what it is you want from the actor, what kind of performance you want from them, you will not get it. Now the key is also, directors have to be a bit of a psychiatrist or psychologist, because they have to understand that saying the same thing to the actor, saying the same words to the actor doesn't necessarily get the same performance out of the actor. Like you have two different actors, and you say to somebody more energy, somebody might go faster, somebody might go louder, somebody might just be more hyperactive in their performance, something like that. There are lots of ways people read what you say in the words you use to direct them. So therefore, I've had to learn to read my talent as well and see how they react to the way I direct them, so I can find the right words. So, for example, if I was using, say, somebody like Todd Haverford and saying one thing and then bringing in Crispin Freeman on another project and saying the same thing, I might, you know, I have to really have a different way of communicating with people. And that's what a director's job is, about communication. Now, from the actor's side, when they come into the booth, a lot of them don't get a lot of information about their character until they come into that booth. So they have to sort of draw their character from the information a director like myself provides them, usually. Hopefully, if it's a main character, they'll have enough information to, background information, support information to do. Sometimes, though, it doesn't always work out that way, especially in video games. One of the advantages of working in anime over video games, in terms of both directing and acting, is that in anime, you get to see the visuals as you're doing the performance. So those elements are filled in for the actor and for the director, so they can sort of see what's going on from episode one all the way to the final episode of the story. They can sort of see the character arc that's going from the beginning to the very end for their character, if they're a character that's in throughout the entire series. When you're working on a video game, video games are non-linear for the most part. I mean, yes, you have RPGs that have a start and at the end, but a lot of times it's like, okay, here's what we're gonna do. You're gonna be doing, this is your character, you're the main character. And this is the line in this scene, 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 and this is the line to go in this branch direction, this is the line to go in this branch of the story. And then after you do all the story-related dialogue, you say, okay, now we're gonna do the battle dialogue. Okay, so you gotta give me a sound for this. You know, it's like, okay, here's three different attack sounds. Now give me a strong attack, light attack, medium attack, things like, and you have to somehow create a character that way. And it's much harder because at best, maybe you'll get an image of the character, a picture of it. And sometimes, I might have a trailer for like the early pre-production of the game so they can sort of see a bit about what the game is about. But for both myself and for the actor, we're trying to work together. It's a collaboration to pull out performance from basically a bunch of lines on a script. Now when you're in a film, you get a movie script. They have things like scene, daytime, somebody's in a chair, smoking a cigar, and thinking about how they're going to take over the world, something like that. And they give you a lot of information. In a video game, it's an Excel sheet, and it just has name of character, line. And it just has the line, name of the character, line. There's no sort of context in between where they are in the story, what's going on, like who were they talking to before? Sometimes it's literally all their lines together, one after the next, and nobody to play off of. And that way, anime is a much more advantageous medium because you can usually see the line of the character before or the line of and the line of the character afterwards. Sometimes those lines haven't been dubbed, but you can still hear it in Japanese and see it in Japanese, so you still get a general idea of how to play the character off those other characters. Video games, it's really, really, as hard as I always say, directing for working in anime is, working in video games is much harder than you need to do. And the same thing goes for a director, because I don't get to see a lot of the games I work, like Street Fighter V, when I got to work on that, basically, yes, I was the producer of Street Fighter IV and all its iterations that came after it, so I know the characters, but we had a lot of story elements to it, which I had no way of seeing what was going on. And I had to sort of I got little descriptions about things, and I had to then talk to my actor and tell them a story, what's going on with the character in this particular scene, how they should sound, how they should make the character feel, and what performance they give from it. And sometimes when you don't get those elements, it sometimes does become, okay, when you have nothing else to fall upon and you have no reference for the actor to pull upon and you have no time, sadly, it sometimes can become, okay, do the line this way. Okay, give me a ha! Or give me a or all right, I want you to really, be a little more, sad or angrier. Now that's directing, when you want to tell somebody to be sad. They use it, I'm so upset, that's how I want you to talk. That's lying, and you try to avoid that. But unfortunately, when you have no information for some of these games, you have to get line reads because the actor has no reference to it. Do you have any questions so far? Yes, over there.
Can you speak to the technical side of how to get the line proper length?
Oh, okay. Well, that's for, if you're talking about we have lip flap that we have to match up to. First comes the translation from Japanese English. Now that's a raw translation. They get polished up, and that's usually what we see in the subtitle version. Then we have something called the adaptation, the ADR adaptation. That's when you have specifically a scriptwriter come along, and their job is to rewrite the dialogue that maintains the meaning that was said in the original, but at the same time will match the lip flap, or in the case of Street Fighter, since we had no lip flap, match the audio length that was provided for us in the Japanese audio files. So it's a very, very challenging thing, but you have, when you have a good writer who understands, they listen to the Japanese audio, they get the beats, the consonants, and the vowels, and then they figure out the exact length. Like, okay, if I said this, blah, 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 it should fit into that. And then comes the actor, because the actor himself or herself also has to understand. They listen to the audio or they watch the lip flap on screen, and they are trying to do a lot of internal timing in their head and trying to figure out what it is, how much they have, how fast they have to say the first part, the second part, the third part. And there are, what's amazing about people like the ones that are here at the convention, like Ian and Michael Tatum, you know, they can listen to something once in Japanese, read the script, and the script is fairly well adapted, you know, even decently enough, they can make it fit, make it sound natural. And that's something you don't get with a lot of actors who just say, well, I'm, you know, there are a lot of stage, a lot of TV actors, a lot of film actors. I like to say, as I said before, there are a lot of great actors, but not every great actor becomes a voice actor. Unfortunately, though, I'm sometimes forced to work with some of these great actors in the recording booth, and it's an honor and privilege to work with them, but they don't have a lot of experience as a voice actor. They think, oh, it's just acting breakfast with a microphone, that's all it is. Except they're not acting to a microphone. They're acting as if the microphone's a camera, and they start moving around, and they start using their body language, they start doing so many different things that are not picked up by the microphone. And when I have to tell them as a director, you know, what it is I'm looking for, and that what they're doing right now is not working because they're giving a performance as if it was an on-camera performance, two things happen. Sometimes the actor will want to learn more about what it is, try to develop their craft because they understand, yeah, this is a whole medium for me, and they sit down and they try to work with me to get the best performance possible. And then there are those who tell me that I don't know what the hell I'm talking about, and how dare I tell them, the greatest actor on the face of the earth, what it is, how to act, how to be an actor. It's like,
it's literally your job.
Yes. You know, that I should not tell them how to give a performance, and that I'm upsetting them because I'm telling them what to do. There's a great, you should look it up on the internet. There are two great ones. There's Orson Welles recording a commercial for butter or peas or something like that. It's like a British commercial, and he is just,
what?
It was peas. And he is just giving the director an insanely hard time. Okay, and just telling him, like, you know, I will not take this. What does in July mean? You're not saying in July. It was like, and then
it doesn't make sense.
Yes.
This is not how you're supposed to speak.
Yes, and you can see how the ego gets in the way. Nobody wants to show, like, when you're an established, respected actor and suddenly you're being schooled on how to act, sometimes you do get a lot, you get a negative reaction as a result. There's another one out there with William Shatner. Well, William Shatner has had it a few times, but there's one where he's being directed during a Star Trek cartoon. And it's a small one where he just says, like, Spock, sabotage the system. don't tell me what to say. It sickens me. But there's one that's like he's doing, I guess the he's doing the narration for some sort of company or something like that, some company's product. And I don't know if they really had a director. They may have had an engineer. It's just being an engineer who they asked to direct. Now, one thing about hiring William Shatner is, when you hire William Shatner, you're going to get William Shatner. You can't take William Shatner to some Lawrence Olivier. It's not going to work. So the point is, you should expect to get a William Shatner-like performance. So William Shatner went into the booth, and he recorded some line. And after he did the line, he's like, "Hi, this is William Shatner. I want you to follow me on a journey to the 21st century. So you sit right back for the next 10 minutes while we show you some amazing things." The engineer director was, "Could you give us some more energy, please? It sounded a bit." And Shatner's like, the next words out of Shatner's like, "Okay, fine." And so we try, and it basically sounds like William Shatner giving the same performance again. And then the guy comes on the microphone and says, and Shatner just goes, "All right, tell me how you want me to do it. Tell me how you want me to do it." And he asked him for a line read. So this engineer goes, "Hi, this is William Shatner. I want you to follow me on a journey for the next 10 minutes into the 21st century. So sit right back now and let me show you some amazing things." So William said, "Okay, is that the way you want to do it?" "Okay. Hi, this is William Shatner." And he was just giving this poor guy an incredibly hard time. Yeah, this guy completely backed up. So, I think your first performance was really good. "Oh, are you sure?" No. "You are the director. You know what the client wants. We're going to do it exactly the way you tell me to do it. Each and every line." And this poor man, you can tell he's like, probably like sweating so profusely right now, because he's just like, not only is he going to, he's pissed off William Shatner, but like his client is going to be so horrified that he hears William Shatner talking, "Hi, this is William Shatner." But, I mean, to be honest, there was a point, I think, that he made, Shatner. There's only so much you can get from a certain person's performance. You can't turn somebody into somebody else so much. I mean, there are actors who are completely versatile. They can become everything. But there are certain actors, you can only be William Shatner. And that's William Shatner. And you can't turn William Shatner into somebody else. And that's another thing that a director has to understand. To know the limitations of the actor you're working with, because there are people who can do great voices as specific characters, but you're not going to turn Gilbert Gottfried into Crispy Freeman. Okay, so it's